Hello and welcome. You are listening to a podcast by the Milner Centre for Evolution at the University of Bath. I'm Professor Turi King, your host, and today I'm talking to Tamás Székely, Professor of Biodiversity, about his research and recent paper in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences titled The Evolution of Sex Roles, the Importance of Ecology and Social Environment. But first, Tamás, you've been researching bird behaviour for over 40 years. What started your interest in this field?
I started off a professional career as ethologist, basically. So I was interested in the behaviour of animals. I never particularly liked birds as such, but I liked behaviour. I just like, as a child, I like watching animals. And birds are super cool because you can watch them. Many of them are diurnal, so they visual, like humans. You can put colorings on them, and you can do some fantastic field-based research with them. So this was the starting point. But over time, I realized that a lot of the questions cannot be simply answered by watching birds. So I started to use more sophisticated techniques, demographic, genomic analysis, immunology, and so forth. Yeah.
So what were some of those early questions that you went, what's going on here?
So in the first few years of behavior observations, I noticed that in some families, the mother or the father leaves the family. And this was small bird is a Kentish plover, and this was shortly after I was a postdoc at EGI in Oxford. And I was just very puzzled. Why do the fathers leave the family? And in this bird, actually, mothers leave the family. And this simple question led to over 20 years of research. And one outcome is a current paper, but we published probably over 100 papers, one way or another related to this question. Yeah.
So this is something that Darwin spotted, isn't it? And he was talking about how there's differences in terms of sex roles. So you've got the females, they're putting so much energy into growing the egg, and then they're looking after the chicks, and the males less so. But this is something that you've been looking at and finding that it's much more complicated than that. And you've seen this over the years, and it's something that you really explore in this paper that's just come out.
Indeed, Darwin was not only a super theoretician in his own time, but he also knew exceedingly well the natural history. So one of his favorite organisms were actually shorebirds. In his book, he cited several examples of shorebirds, how they behaved. And indeed, across many organisms, the mother is the one who put a lot more resources, a lot more energy into reproduction, and they are the ones who look after the young as well. But not all organisms. There are species, including some of the shorebirds, which actually have the fathers have a very significant role, including humans, actually, in rearing the family. So there's a whole range of what we call now sexual behavior, what the females, what the males do in order to increase their Darwinian fitness. Yeah.
So why are shorebirds so interesting? Because I know this has been a real area of interest for you. Why shorebirds?
So it's a group of birds, about 200, 250 species. When I started the research in late 1980s, I quickly discovered that many shorebirds live in open places. So you can actually watch them very far away, and you can follow their movement. And importantly, many of them nest on the ground, which means that you can handle the eggs, you can ring the chicks, and you can follow the whole families in the move. Unlike forest birds, which tend to disappear very quickly behind the leaves or behind the bushes, shorebirds in general tend to be in the open. And then, of course, it's a wonderful thing because you can record where they are, record their behavior. You can record their families itself, yeah.
And shorebirds are quite interesting, aren't they? Because they have a real range of how they look after their young, this kind of thing, don't they?
Yeah, it is exactly what Darwin already noted in his famous book on sexual selection, and he introduced the idea that not just the survival of the fittest, but survival of the sexiest can also play a part in evolution, essentially. Darwin used actually several examples. One of his favorite examples was the ruff. The males are larger than the females, more pugnacious, they're more fighty, and and only the female look after the young. Darwin also noted that in other shorebirds, like phalaropes and painted snipes, actually the females are more ornamented, they are larger than the males, and only the males look after the young. So this is what often called sex role reversal, because the conventional sex is reversed. Indeed, even in India, at that time, they used the button quail species, which have the females larger than the males, and the button quails were used in a kind of reverse cockerel fight. Of course, it's illegal now in pretty much everywhere. The female button quails killed each other in a cage when they were put together. So it's essentially the opposite of what the cockerels do in a stage and now illegal fights, yeah.
So it's basically about sex roles. So it wasn't Darwin kind of thinking like, okay, so the females, they're putting all the energy into raising the chicks, and it's the male birds that are basically fighting for access to the females in order to be able to have chicks. But you've been finding that this is really different, and you get all different types of mating patterns and all sorts.
Yeah, indeed. Darwin suspected that it relates to sex ratio, actually, in his book, and not even a specialist picked it up, people who work on sexual selection. But Darwin was very clear that the ratio of males and females in the population should play a role how intense sexual selection is. It's not rocket science, but this is how it is. And our research is actually confirming Darwin's idea, but in a funny and interesting tweaks, because we also uncovering that not just the sex ratio, but also ecological conditions play a role in it. So let me just illustrate one aspect of our research. So the population sex ratios, in other words, how many adult males and adult females are in a population, have a large variation. Across birds, interestingly, we have largely more males in the population than females. And in mammals, interestingly, the general pattern that there are more females than males. Now, in shorebirds, interestingly, there is both male bias, we call them male bias sex ratios, in other words, more males than females, and also female bias sex ratios. And this predicts the breeding system in a very simple way. So if you have many males in a population, then the males, instead of trying to find another sexual partner, they actually stay at home and look after the babies, because it's just so difficult to find a new partner. There are too many guys competing for a small number of females. But interestingly, in shorebirds, you also have the females where, because in many shorebirds, there are actually females who enjoy the benefit of having more partners. So when there are many males in a population, then the females are the choosy ones. So I think the shorebirds, for some reasons which we actually don't know, there's variation in their sex ratios, and the breeding systems, who look after the young and who competes for a partner, is actually interestingly matches the sex ratios. Yeah.
So what's causing the differences in the sex ratios? Because I'm guessing that when the chicks are born, there's pretty much even numbers. So what's happening? Do you know?
Yeah, I think the short answer is we don't know. So in many birds, the offspring sex ratios are close to 50-50, not entirely, but very close. But as the babies get older and they immature, there are all subtle processes kick in. For instance, in a Kentish bubble, what we studied for many years, we picked up that the baby girls die very early on. They look identical. They're just very cute little things. But the girl mortality was about four times higher than the male chick mortality. We still don't know why. But interestingly, another plover population, actually boy mortality is higher. So these are tiny little boys, and they just die a lot more often than the girls. Now, we're looking at immune system differences, we're looking at behavioral differences, and we're trying to understand what causes the different chick mortalities. Adults can also die. I mean, one example actually from humans, a few days ago I talked to a human geneticist about this. Vast majority of diseases, well, expressed actually in males. So for instance, in COVID, few people know that the infection rates were similar. So the similar number of males and females got infected, but the morbidity, how many got serious hospital treatment, including Tamás, myself, was actually significantly male biased. So males suffered a lot more. Of course, autoimmune diseases is a female bias. But influenza, for instance, the papers I've seen, again, males suffer more than females. So the sexes, from a genetic point of view, not evenly handling the diseases. Sorry, it's just in your genes.
Mm. So this actually brings us quite nicely to your paper, because what you've been spotting and understanding is that in terms of the evolution of sex roles, there's important around the ecology, the social environment. So for this current paper, what were you doing? What were you looking at and how were you doing it? And then what did you find?
Yep. This paper took about 4 years to fully develop, and we used a very interesting branch of science called comparative analysis. Of course, Darwin did a lot of it. You compare ecology behavior across different species. But in the last 20 years, there were new statistical tools developed to understand what might be the best predictor or reason for the different parental behavior and mating system across shorebirds. So in other words, this paper was based on literature data, including actually some of our own data. People went out, they reported how many males and females are in a population. They also reported whether the father or the mother looked after the babies. And we actually pulled it together in one statistical framework and looked to see whether sex ratios and ecology predicted the behavior. And one of the main findings was that indeed, the population sex ratio was the best predictor of mating systems and parenting. So if there were many females in a population, then the females were more inclined to stay at home because there were just so many other females they had to compete to have a partner. And in this situation, the males actually had an upper hand selecting partner. As opposed to the male bias populations, then essentially males had a significantly bigger role in parenting and the females had more choice among potential partners. Now, the second main result is a bit more difficult to explain. In the last few years, there were scientists who actually started to ponder whether the sex ratio biases facilitating mating system variation or vice versa. Their argument is simply that looking after the young or competing a partner could be costly. And it means mortality cost. And mortality is a demographic trait. So they argue that the association between sex ratio differences and breeding system is because competition, sexual selection, producing babies, and it's hugely costly, shifts the sex ratios. Now, of course, it's very difficult to test this idea because we're talking about data from a literature, but there is a very clever statistical technique we actually did use, which showed that the association is more likely sex ratio differences emerging in a population, and this somehow facilitate the mating system rather than the alternative hypothesis where the mating system and parenting costs could drive sex ratio bias. So I think this was actually the second important outcome of the research. And so far, this is the only study which actually managed to find a consistent result with our interpretation that sex ratio differences in a natural population somehow feed into behavioral differences.
So its sex ratio is basically driving which sex is the one that ends up looking after the chicks. But is there anything else going in there?
Yeah, it does. What we find is that how closely you breed your partner is called breeding density, also modulated this. So you just imagine that if you have to travel many kilometers to find a partner, as opposed to having a potential partner around you, makes a huge difference, and it does. So what we also found that the breeding density, which is always an indication how much resources you have. So in good places, you actually have more animals, amplify the sex ratio biases. So that's why our study actually supported both of them. We call it social environment sex ratio. Well, social environment is actually a super interesting thing because, you know, humans, we're just such a social things, and we actually don't notice, but even in humans, the population sex ratio influences our mate choice and also our mate selecting strategies.
So Tamás, in the work that you're doing, are you finding that climate change is having an impact here?
Yes, definitely. So we're seeing that climatic variations, not only temperature, but also extreme weather, storms, and so forth, are influencing animal populations worldwide. One aspect, what we're hoping to study, is the impact of heat shock and extreme heat, because some of the populations we work is in tropical climates, and we want to understand how the climatic variations are influencing males and females, and in total, how the different reproductive success, what we see currently in nature, will change in future. One simple scenario, for instance, that in extreme weather, we know it from our own work, the parents have to cooperate to protect their young against from extreme heat or extreme cold. So from this idea, we would expect that the parental cooperation, what we actually see across many species, will strengthen because they have to provide food together in order to reproduce successfully. Yeah.
So, Tamás, what is the thing that you are most passionate about?
Yeah, that's a very good question. What I'm seeing increasingly, my main mission is just try to speak up for field biology. I remember when I was undergraduate student, and at the end of my undergraduate course, I was able to recognize 1,000 species of animals. Not just the species name, family, order, class. But it's just a super cool feeling that you walk in a forest and you just like sharpshooting, bang, bang, bang. You know, because it's just biology. I think this have gone, and I'm not saying we should bring it back, but we do need to make the younger generations to get interested in nature, because it's just rapidly disappearing. And we have to find a way of taking them to the field and just allow them to interact with nature. And many great biologists, actually, whatever they ended up in genetics, physiology, some of the neurobiologists' friends, is actually started off just talking about wildlife, essentially, as a child. And I think it's a super cool thing to have a starting point in nature. And of course, you do all kind of fancy stuff in a lab, but I think nature is just brilliant.
Tamás, thank you so much for talking with me. This was a podcast by the Milner Centre for Evolution at the University of Bath. I'm Turi King, and thank you for listening. If you have any thoughts or comments on this or any other episodes, please contact us via our X channel, at Milner Centre. For more information about the Milner Centre for Evolution, you can visit our website.